Tomorrow will mark to the day the first anniversary of the death of Elvis Presley, the one and only king of rock and roll. For Elvis's loyal fans, and some of them might be called true fanatics, the king still lives. Geraldo Rivera has the story.
Thank you, Year. The public's response to the loss of Elvis Presley is similar to the very emotional way fans reacted in the 1920s to the death of silent screen star Rudolph Valentino. But because of the media, probably, the Elvis phenomenon is 1,000 times more widespread. There's another main difference. Mourning for Elvis has become an industry, the selling of a legend. There are currently 28 Elvis Presley books on the market, for instance. And in the last year alone, they've sold a total of about 10 million copies. Then there are the records. Elvis sold 500 million records during his 23-year career as the king of rock and roll. And reports on the record sales since his death range all the way from 30 million to an additional 200 million records. Add in the sale of relics and mementos and the tours and everything else, and the legend business figures out at about $250 million, $250 million so far. I don't know where it'll all end, but this is where it began.
We want to thank you from the bottom of our heart. And now,
don't be cruel.
You know I can be found sitting home all alone. If you can't come around, at least please telephone. Don't be cruel.
He was the first and greatest of the world's rock and roll stars. The hillbilly cat, the working class hero, the first to really define the limits and the potential of rock and roll. He was generous, sentimental, sexual, and cool. And a year after his funeral in Memphis, Elvis Presley is a more important feature on America's cultural landscape in death than he was at least during the last several years of his life. He's been elevated to something like sainthood by millions of adoring fans. And a new industry, the marketing of the legend, the buying and selling of Elvis relics, has grown into a multi-million dollar business. Some of the dealers are motivated by love, others by a hard-nosed desire to cynically exploit the void Elvis's death left in the hearts and minds of a generation of lovers. Ginger Alden was the king's fiancée and the person who found him lying on the floor after the fatal heart attack.
I think some people are taking advantage of his death, and I don't think those are the really sincere people. And like a girlfriend of mine was down on the day he died to try to get in to see his body, and she said right then there were people selling Elvis t-shirts. Now, I think that's horrible. I think those people didn't really love Elvis, just the name.
It's like a circus. People are just trying to make money any way they can off anything Elvis, you know, pictures of him. I saw in a paper that somebody had a bed sheet that was Elvis's. And I think it's crazy. I don't know why people do something like that.
A year after his death, the crowds here at Elvis's Graceland Mansion are larger even than they were during his lifetime. His home has become a shrine and this city's largest tourist attraction, bringing people and money to Memphis. For the last week, more than 10,000 people a day have made the pilgrimage past his gravesite, many of them taking the opportunity also to visit the Elvis Presley Memorial Shopping Center across the street from Graceland. It's a place where every conceivable Elvis item is for sale. Come and get them while they're hot. Elvis records and buttons, bubble gum and belt buckles, statues, umbrella stands, posters, postcards, and postmortems.
David, I mean, the people have just tripled. I mean, just keep on more and more.
Where do they come from?
All over the country and all over the world. It's unreal. People, foreign people are in here every single day. And I can't believe that that many people come, but I think it's great.
The people who buy Elvis memorabilia range from casual fans to truly devoted followers. Jean Brown is a Houston homemaker who's the proud possessor of one of the nation's most complete Elvis collections.
In her Elvis room are such treasures as a block of wood smashed by the king himself during karate practice. There's also a piece of tile taken from Elvis's bathroom after remodeling, and a very special picture.
And it's a glow-in-the-dark picture. You can hold it near the light or have it in a near a window or something, and it absorbs the light, and when you turn the light off, it's just like he's sitting there. You can see his teeth and the whites of his eyes, and it's just like he's there.
Although there are dealers all over the country, the biggest Elvis business is done at the conventions. In their own minds, at least, it's almost as if they had come to see the king himself. Hundreds and hundreds of people behind me lining up on the sidewalk outside the Statler Hilton Hotel in New York City. They've come for a weekend convention, a convention featuring Elvis memorabilia. This convention is being staged by Paul Lichter, the nation's number one dealer in memories. His business grosses tens of thousands of dollars a month. A true fan during Elvis's life, Lichter has been described as the man who cries all the way to the bank.
Sure that Elvis was still the brightest star in the universe.
Are you saying that you're not in this for money?
I'm saying that 50% of me is a businessman where Elvis is concerned, and 100% of me is love.
Of the Elvis items that he owned, is everything precious now?
Yes, it is. Then again, also depending on whom has it and who they're trying to sell it to. I've found that another sad aspect of this whole thing is that many of his friends, many relatives, have contacted me wanting to sell very personal items.
Like what?
Handwritten letters, photographs, his musician's union card, his automobile, his coffee mug. As a matter of fact, for this tribute event, we had someone that had a sink that claimed that Elvis washed his hair in it, and would we auction it off?
After an eight-year absence from the concert stage, the real Elvis made a 1969 comeback in Las Vegas. In many ways, Las Vegas was Elvis Presley's second city. In the last decade of his life, he performed here more often than any place else, and his fans came from all over the world to see him. The bizarre thing is that those fans are still coming. You see, Las Vegas has the somewhat dubious distinction of being the world's capital of the Elvis Presley imitators. Morris Batesak has the distinction of being the only Presley impersonation on the script that incorporates three different phases of Elvis's career. Jailhouse Rock is in part one of Morris's trilogy. Johnny Hara does the best late Elvis. He might be a little weak musically, but he does bear an uncanny resemblance to the king. And the word clone has been used more than once in Johnny's reviews. His show at Top Vegas Prices is sold out almost every night. And of all the would-be Elvis doubles, Johnny seems to take himself most seriously. But to me, the most remarkable thing is how totally the audience seems to accept the Elvis illusion. Shouting, screeching, screaming, and even fighting over Johnny's scars. He boasts of how much his mother looks like Elvis's mom. And Johnny has gone as far as naming his daughter Lisa Marie, just like Elvis's 10-year-old.
I know that no matter what I do, there's never going to be another Elvis. If the only thing that I want to do, sir, is if I can make people happy on something I might do or in my show, then that makes the whole thing that I'm doing worthwhile. I just, I've been doing, you know, over 19 years. I just want people to be happy.
One person not made very happy by Johnny's act is rival Elvis impersonator Rick Saucedo.
He's into cars, into the whole Elvis life, to the talking and everything. And to me, that's a bunch of bull. And that is a person who's going to live his life, and who knows, he might even croak at 42. If he thinks he's Elvis. And that's why, you know, He's all mixed up. He don't know what he's doing, if he's coming or going.
Rick may be put out by Johnny's total assumption of Elvis's personality, but it's Rick's act that wins the Rock and Roll Heaven Award with its finale number, featuring Rick as Elvis ascending to the heavens through clouds of dry ice. By the latest estimates, there are approximately 1,500 professional imitators, some grossing as much as $1 million a year. They say Elvis Presley thought imitation the sincerest form of flattery. Maybe he did. But the imitators and the marketing of Elvis relics and records are only part of the selling of the legend. Another very big business is books. And in Elvis's case, everyone who had the remotest connection with the man has now written one. And that includes his karate teacher, the man who introduced him to his wife, his uncle, his bookkeeper, his secretary, and his bodyguards. And each book purports to tell more about Elvis's private life than the other, even his stepmother's.
I would have liked to have kept Elvis the teenage idol, the young man that just sang to the girl, the little boy from Tupelo that didn't swear and had no bad habits. But you know, success has a way of changing people. And so the truth is in the book.
Everybody had their own point of view, their own part of his life that they lived. And there's a lot of things that everybody, one person can't remember. A lot of good things, a lot of bad things, and the book will tell them all.
Now, you wrote a book, didn't you?
Yes, I got one out.
How's it doing?
It's doing fine so far. Just we don't have it out too many places right now. It's more or less in Memphis right now. In all the blanks, I've sold quite a few by mail order. It's going pretty good.
Well, there's two versions, I understand.
Well, it's the same book, but it's a small, a $10 one, and then a 25. The 25 has a leather back, and it's with the gold gates on the front.
After Elvis died, the publishing company rushed it up, and it's a good book, and it's a first-class book, and it's a human side of Elvis.
I was just stating to him, a message to him, and I think he got it. I think he got it, Raldo.
You don't think the book hurt him?
It may have hurt him. But I also know that he knows how much he hurt us when he let us go. And I think that that's the reason when we started the book.
Well, how do you respond to a book like the West Brothers put out?
The West Brothers? I've never met them. I don't know them. But I'm sure that was blown way out of proportion. And Elvis knew it was coming out. And I talked to him quite often about it. And he told me that it wasn't the content of the book, but the principle. Because he had done so much for their families and helped them out in different ways, and for them to turn and do something like that, that's what hurt him.
Ginger Alden is about the only one who hasn't written a book. Since Elvis's death, she's pursued her career as an actress. Her first film will be entitled The Living Legend. The casting is inspired. Art mimics life. The movie is about a country rock superstar, overweight, over 40, and struggling with midlife crisis. Despite the books, the movies, the conventions, and the millions being made on the selling of the legend, true believers can take comfort in the fact that there was and will always be only one Elvis Presley.